The Corsair K70 was the second keyboard I ever bought, and I've been in love ever since. So with this new release, I just had to get one. We'll be diving into the tech, the differences, and if it's worth the upgrade. The Pro version now has a tournament switch, double shot PBT keycaps, a standard bottom row, detachable USB 3.0 Type A to USB-C braided cable, AXON hyperprocessing that supports 8,000 Hertz polling and 4,000 Hertz key scanning, a magnetic palm rest, and a new darker, sleeker design with a slightly different profile. The MK.2 and the Pro version both have aluminum anodized brushed finish, Cherry MX switches, onboard macro recording, individual RGB key, programmable lighting and key mapping, NKRO full key rollover, 100% anti-ghosting, 8 MB of onboard memory, dedicated media keys, which include a volume roller, profile key, brightness key, and Windows lock key, 2-stage tilt, cable routing, and a soft touch palm rest. Whew, that was a lot of tech, but does any of it translate into the real world? You may want to sit down for this devastating news. They've removed the USB pass-through switch for a removable USB-C cord and tournament switch. Some may be throwing hands right now, but please take it out on the virtual battlefield. Out of respect, and we get a moment of silence for a fan favorite dying. Thank you. Honestly, I'm glad they made this change, and just for the record, the unsubscribe button is down on the right. Feel free to press it at any time. Personally, having a cord that I can easily remove or customize is totally worth it to me, as I like to use/test different keyboards, and having the ability to have a single cord that is thin and doesn't take up a lot of room and is hot swappable is amazing. The tournament switch is neat, as when you toggle it, the lighting goes static and turns off all macros and customizations to quickly adhere to tournament guidelines. The stock static lighting is red, but you can adjust it to whatever you like in the ICUE software, which automatically saves it directly to the keyboard. Personally, I just use it to eliminate distractions. The switch is on the back where the USB pass-through port used to be, making it easy to find and feel solid to activate. But I'm curious on your thoughts. What do you think of this change? Let me know in the comment section down below. Previously, the Mark II came with ABS keycaps, except for the Mark II SE because it was special. ABS keycaps tend to be smooth, thin, pick up oil easily, which can make them shiny and not in the good way. And the coating can wear off over time, causing those who peck to no longer be able to type. With PBT keycaps, they are double-shotted, meaning they have two layers and are made from higher quality plastic. This makes them feel a lot better tactically and withstand the effects of time better. More specifically, they tend to be a bit rougher, allowing you to have better grip, don't pick up oil as well, and the coating doesn't wear off over time. With them being thicker and better quality plastic, it changes the sound and feel of the keys. Corsair did a fantastic job with these, and I absolutely love them, as they are 1.5 millimeters thick, slightly rough, and tapered on the sides, pushing your finger into the middle of the key, have clean, professional writing, the secondary keys illuminate, and the lighting shines through them well. With a nice dark/matte black look, they remind me a lot of Batman. Or maybe that's because I'm excited for the new Batman movie and sit in a Batman chair. Some may call me a fan, but I don't know what they're talking about. The Cherry MX mechanical switches continue to be premium. You have your choice between red, blue, brown, silent red, and speed silver. You can check the description for the full specs and details on each one of those switches. Quickly, red, silent red, and speed silver are linear, meaning they have no tactile bump or audible click, making them smooth throughout the entire process. The silent portion just means they have tech in them to dampen the sound, but stock reds really aren't that loud to begin with. The speed silver switch just means that they have reduced actuation and travel time, making them faster. Blues are some of my personal favorites, as they have a tactile bump and audible click, which are like mating sounds to me. The browns just have a tactile bump, but no audible click. I find the browns or the blues to be the best for typing. Most prefer linear for gaming. I got the speed silver switches in mine. They feel great as they spring up very fast, making them feel really responsive and crisp. I still prefer Corsair's OPX switches. Those are only available on the K100, which is my main keyboard. I really do wish that they would release those switches to be used on more than just the K100, but more specifically, I'd prefer to see it on a TKL version because I'd be all over that like peanut butter and jelly. Is that even a saying? No? Anyways, this keyboard feels great to type and game on, as the PBT keycaps make a huge difference in the feel. Here's a quick sound test. With the more professional font, darker keycaps, and the darker aluminum, the RGB really shines on this guy, making it look excellent. Animations are extremely smooth and attractive. Lighting is accurate, including whites. For those of you who don't know, in the ICUE software, you can adjust the lighting and animations to whatever you want, along with changing the keys to be whatever you like. Seriously, you can come up with some really cool things, as the software is incredibly powerful. Personally, I've made a function key that when I press, allows me to change the color to whatever I want with the press of a button, which also allows me to illuminate keys that have a bind to them. It supports up to 8 megabytes of onboard storage, which equates to about 50 profiles and 20 layers of lighting, depending on the complexity. But I've always had issues trying to get them to work correctly. But for those of you who want to avoid ICUE like the plague, as it has been known to cause issues on people's systems as it's a bully to other programs, can be a resource hog as it logs all kinds of information and not be user friendly. But it looks good, which is really all that matters. You can use the function and the 1 through 0 keys to cycle through different lighting effects. By using some other keys, you can further customize, but not to the extent of using ICUE. Also, with the NKRO full key rollover and 100% anti-ghosting, you can press every single key at the same time and it will still register. All in all, top marks here. The next big thing is the AXON processing. Since this is a big portion of the upgrade, I am going to spend some time on it, so you're welcome to skip ahead if you'd like. This has been around for a while, but is new to the K70 lineup. Best focus up, because we're about to get nerdy. The AXON processing is Corsair's real-time operating system running on their microcontroller unit that allows for record-breaking throughput, ultra-low latencies, and can prioritize important tasks. In other words, it is optimized to process instructions quickly and efficiently, is multi-threaded to take full advantage of the microcontroller unit, allowing it to process complex instructions such as key presses, 20 layer lighting, 8000 Hertz hyperpoling, and 4000 Hertz key scanning all at the same time while prioritizing advanced scheduling to ensure critical key presses get through when they need to. Mind equals blown. Okay, Tommy, you use a bunch of fancy words there, but what does any of that actually mean? Well, key scanning is how fast the keyboard registers a key press. With AXON, it's 4000 Hertz or 0.25 milliseconds compared to 1000 Hertz or 1 millisecond. Debounce delay is how fast the keyboard transmits information, which is 8000 Hertz or 0.125 milliseconds. It also has improved processing to eliminate debounce delay, as mechanical switches have a spring in them, and due to that, it bounces, which can register additional clicks accidentally. So they add a delay to prevent that from happening. I think putting this in a direct example would be helpful, as the main thing you will notice is the 8000 Hertz polling and 4000 Hertz key scanning. As with your normal performance gaming keyboard, it is 1000 Hertz for both and has been for a very long time. The chain that we go through with each button press is you react to something, then you press the key. The key scanning registers that you press the key. A debounce delay happens to prevent accidental double or triple or quad clicks. The processor processes this information and the polling rate transmits that info, and then you go through the entire process again. With AXON, the key scanning is 4000 Hertz or 0.25 milliseconds. There is no debounce delay. Processing time is nearly instant, and the hyperpolling is 8000 Hertz or 0.125 milliseconds, leading to an overall response time of 0.25 milliseconds. With your average performance gaming keyboard, the key scanning is 1000 Hertz or 1 millisecond. There is no debounce delay. The processing time is about 1 millisecond, and the polling rate is 1000 Hertz or 1 millisecond, leading to an overall latency of about 2 milliseconds. With a standard gaming keyboard, they could have slower than 1000 Hertz key scanning, up to 8 milliseconds of debounce delay, greater than 1 millisecond processing time, and slower than 1000 Hertz hyperpolling, leading to 8 or more milliseconds of average latency per press, with standard keyboards being even worse. Yikes. Anyways, all of that is really like splitting hairs at this point, because obviously 1 millisecond, 0.25 milliseconds, 8 milliseconds isn't going to be like huge differences, but does build up over time. Put simply, for the average layman, AXON allows your keyboard to be 8 times faster than other performance gaming keyboards, making it feel smoother and more responsive. To me, this makes a noticeable difference, and I can tell a difference between it and a stock board. Best explained by feeling the difference between 60 Hertz and 144 Hertz for monitors. You can still perform relatively the same, but things just don't feel as responsive or smooth, and it gives you a competitive edge, making movement feel effortless and natural, making me not want to go back to the good old days of 1000 Hertz, but not dramatic enough to where I'd say that you need to sell sell your child and get this keyboard right now. The only downside is that it uses more CPU processing power due to the increased demand, but I haven't had any issues with this on my Ryzen 3800X, and all games support it without any issues, unlike with 8000 Hertz mice, which is a totally different story. Other keyboards now support this as well, such as the Razer Huntsman V2, so Corsair isn't the only one with this type of tech, but I do believe that Corsair was the first to the scene. I'd show you the Aesthetic Differences, but no longer own a regular Mark II variant, so you'll just have to do that yourself by doing some Google image searches. But basically, they changed the style to that of the K100, making it look more professional. The media keys have a slight redesign, have the same volume roller, which is very smooth and doesn't wobble, but flattened out the mute button. They moved the profile key, brightness key, and Windows lock key to further to the left and made them flat. The entire board has more of an incline naturally, and at the bottom has a straight lip, making it more comfortable to type on. I also think that it has a lot less room on the sides here, which I really like, as it takes up a lot less room, except for the tap still sticking out quite a bit. Onto the palm rest itself, it continues to be very similar, but looks slightly different, as I want to say last time it had some cutouts, where this time it's all bumpy through the whole thing with a little Corsair tag right there, and it magnetically attaches to the bottom of the device, which is very nice. Where I think previously it would click into place and that could technically scratch like the bottom of the device and up here. I also think the aluminum overall is a lot darker and more mysterious while highlighting the RGB better. I'm Batman. I don't use macros because I like to waste my precious time, so I'm not going to go in depth on them, but the Windows lock key has a secondary function to allow for convenient on-the-fly macro recording. When ICUE is not open, they are saved to the onboard storage. When ICUE is open, it is saved to the current ICUE profile. Play, pause, forward, backward, and stop feel fantastic and only wobble a bit if you try. The volume rocker is extremely smooth and feels fantastic. The mute button, profile button, brightness button, and Windows lock button, that's what happens when you don't actually look at your screen when you're pointing at something, has mild spring back force. They aren't terrible by any means, but are the worst part of this keyboard. You have four large rubber pads with cable routing, along with a two-step vertical riser, which the second step is just so itty-bitty that I just don't really get the point of it. But hey, you know, whatever. I would say they're all solid when I'm actually using the keyboard like usual. They don't go anywhere. Even if I go left and right, there's a lot of stiffness to it. So I think they are excellent. The magnetic touch palm rest is nice. It attaches well with no padding, but still feels good as it is quite soft and my moisturized baby hands enjoy it a lot. I prefer to keep it on even though it takes up nearly twice as much space. Moving on to the conclusion, I talked about a lot of things in this review. Obviously, there is a ton of tech inside this thing and it translates beautifully to the real world, with my only complaints being the flat buttons, that it can show dust and other debris easily, and there was another one that I mentioned somewhere in the review, but I cannot remember it. But all of that tech doesn't mean squat if it doesn't feel or sound good. To me, this keyboard makes me want to get on my computer and use it because it really feels good, sounds good, and is just fun to use. And when I'm not using it, I like to just look at it because it's absolutely beautiful. Seriously, just look at that thing. It is which means this is an easy recommendation, especially since keyboards almost never fail, so you can just buy one and you're good for years. Unless if you're a sycophant like me and like to burn money on peripherals you don't need. This retails for $169.99, but the Mark II version went on sale regularly for about $110 to $130. And imagine this will do the same thing, so you could always wait for a sale. Or I would imagine that they're trying to get rid of old stock, so there's going to be some incredible prices on the Mark II variant. So you could definitely try to look out for those. This is the end of this review, so I will see you and you'll be with us on the next one. God bless and peace out.